So let's talk about this now. Professor Tom Solomon, who is working on improvements for a testing kit for the virus. Very good morning, to you. So we'll come on to the testing kit in just a moment. Hearing the statistics we're hearing now, the increased numbers in China, the first cases in Europe as well, can you put this in some kind of perspective for us?
Yeah, I think the best comparison is with SARS, which you may remember happened in 2003, and that was similar. It was a coronavirus. It spread from animals to humans for the first time. But the difference back then was that the epidemic grew to quite a size in China before they admitted that they had a problem and they got help. So this time it's been a very different response. They've been very quick to let people know about it, very quick to share all the information that they have.
Can I just break this down? So if we start with it coming from animals, how? Is it being bitten or eating?
No, it's thought to have happened in one of these wet markets. So in China and in much of Asia, there are markets where live animals are sold because people like to buy very fresh meat, so fresh that it's still alive. And these are sometimes very compact markets, and essentially the excrement from the animals can contaminate humans. So it probably was a sick animal or an animal carrying the virus, and it probably was the excrement of that that maybe was inhaled by a human or on food. But very unlikely to be a bite, based on what we know about this type of virus.
Let's talk a bit about the prevention of the spreading of the disease. We understand the Chinese authorities, for example, are building this new hospital. This is about isolating individuals. And as I understand it, one of the problems with the SARS virus is often hospitals were a place where, ironically, given people going there for care, they were seen as hotbeds, places where the disease was actually spreading.
Well, sadly, that is the case. And we know that a proportion of the people who have been ill are healthcare workers, and sadly today we've heard that the first healthcare worker, a doctor, has died from this infection. And you know, I think that's worth bearing in mind that when most people are hiding themselves away, healthcare workers have to go and help.
Can I just check, where are you getting that information from? Because that's not something
that's reported about 10 minutes ago from China. One of the doctors who was a 62-year-old doctor who was looking after patients in Wuhan.
Well, that brings up lots of other questions in terms of the kind of people who are dying, because we understand the death toll is now 41 in China. That's the latest number we've received.
Yes.
62 years old, relatively young, really. And you would expect, we obviously don't know the details about this person, but healthy in the healthcare service. And we're seeing pictures behind you of people with masks, and whether or not that is effective, whether or not there's adequate protection for those who are being exposed to this.
Well, from the pictures I've seen, the health medical staff in China are wearing more than just masks. They're wearing more protective gear. It seems that the people who are most likely to get sick are those who are over 40, and also those with other medical problems, chronic medical problems. Whereas, of course, the majority of people who have been hospitalised have survived. And in fact, there's probably thousands of other people who've been infected, but who haven't even been unwell enough to go to hospital. So I think it's important to bear that in mind in terms of getting the overall perspective.
We mentioned at the beginning, you're involved in research around testing. So what are the procedures at the moment, and what is it you're working on?
Well, at the University of Liverpool, I'm the director of the Health Protection Research Unit in Emerging Infections. And we our unit has helped deal with lots of outbreaks like this. MERS coronavirus was a previous one, Ebola was a previous one, and we do research in all sorts of areas to try and support Public Health England and the public health response. There is already a diagnostic test which PHE, Public Health England, have developed very rapidly. We're working in Liverpool on developing newer tests. It's not actually work led by me in the lab. The other thing we're trying to support is the modelling studies to try and work out how many people really have been infected in China.
The time frame here is clearly crucial, because we were talking about this yesterday, that the time it takes to do a blood test, for example, to be secure that the information is correct. And given the outbreak and the danger of it spreading, that becomes more and more important, doesn't it?
Yeah, and this is why this outbreak has been so different to previous ones, because immediately that the Chinese had information about what the virus was and its genetic sequence, they shared this information with the world, so that then every lab in the world that wanted to could look at the sequence and create their own diagnostic tests, which means that, you know, on this occasion, the tests are ready even before any patients have arrived in the UK.
Who copes with this well? Because you refer to the experience that China obviously has because of the SARS virus in 2003. We're now reporting that some cases have been found for the first time in Europe, in France. Who is equipped to deal with this well? I mean, it comes down to more than medical expertise. It comes down to an infrastructure, doesn't it, and information.
It does, and so most countries now, you know, over the last 20 years, we've got better at dealing with these emerging virus outbreaks. So we have systems on standby. People know at the hospitals, for example, at the Royal Liverpool University Hospital where I work, colleagues there have been doing the drill, preparing for what to do if we have a patient there with,
and what is
with
that?
This infection.
What would happen?
Well, it's about getting them, if they are positive, is getting them into isolation as quickly as possible. One of the issues actually is how we respond to people who perhaps have come back from Wuhan and have a fever and are at home. What's the initial thing that happens? Because you don't necessarily want them to come into an A&E department. So people are being encouraged, if they're in that situation, to phone NHS 111 and get advice there.
It is worth saying, as we know, as we stands at the moment, there have been no positive tests for the virus.
That's right, there haven't been any positives yet in this country, but it seems very likely that it will happen sooner or later. And I think the important thing to remember is that we are ready to deal with it. And the other important thing is that where there have been cases in other countries, there's not yet been secondary transmission. So there's been the one imported case, but it's not yet been passed on to others and others.
I suppose one thing that's reassuring as well is that whole idea of a super spreader, someone who passes the disease on to more, 10 people or more. We haven't seen a case of that yet, or that's not been reported.
No, we haven't seen that yet. And people may remember with SARS coronavirus, this terrible story of somebody who was unwell. They were in a hotel in Hong Kong. The hotel had faulty drain pipes, and effectively the sewage, the vomit and diarrhea from this patient was spread to others through the spray from these downpipes. So, you know, that's the kind of situation that we want to avoid.
Professor, really interesting hearing your expertise this morning. It's Professor Tom Solomon, who's from the University of Liverpool.
Thank you.